Hey guys, Andre from High Performance Academy. Welcome along to another one of our webinars. Now today we're going to be diving into EcuFlash, the program that one of the programs that is commonly used for open source reflashing, particularly on the Subaru and Mitsubishi platforms. Not just restricted to that, but we're going to find out what reflashing is, we're going to find out what open source versus commercial is, what that means, and we'll dive into the software. This is an introductory tour. We have just finished filming a worked example that's going to be added into our practical reflash tuning course. Merely days away from having that released, but this is a good opportunity to give us a bit of a walkthrough for those who maybe don't know what that software is. Plus, over the coming members webinars, we will be adding some more specific content around EcuFlash and reflashing on that Subaru platform, so you've got that all to come. Before we dive into that though, just an update over the last week, and if you were lucky enough to join us last week, you got to hear all about the fun that I had at the racetrack putting the racecraft car into the wall through driver stupidity. Yep, there you go. I said it. Anyway, let's just jump back into the laptop screen for a moment for a quick recap for those who haven't yet managed to share in my suffering. That is what the rearranged front of the racecraft 86 looks like. Here's another angle just to make sure that you're getting the full impact. See what I did there? Of what went on. And again, for those who have no idea why this happened or how it happened, this was four laps into a six lap sprint race coming onto the bridge at Highlands Motorsport Park. For some reason, I seem to be having trouble finding whereabouts the gears were in the H-pad and six speed gearbox. I'm going to claim that it's simply down to a season driving a sequential gearbox. Anyway, coming onto the bridge, shifting down under brakes from fifth down into fourth gear. Instead of fourth, I managed to get sixth, which in itself was a really big deal. However, I was holding off a car behind me, and in order to not lose any more time than possible, I tried again, as you would, to slot it into fourth gear, this time grabbing second instead, which has the same effect as pulling on the handbrake. Compression locked the rear, and the rest is history. However, we are not here to dwell on my stupidity. We are in the midst of getting the car repaired, and this is what it looked like once we got all of the broken panels off it. It actually looked a lot worse at the track than it turned out to be, and we were really lucky that basically all of the damage was limited to parts that bolted off the car, and this means that we weren't expecting a massive bill from the panel shop actually straightening the car. Got all of the parts ordered, and the fact that there is a fairly active Toyota TR86 racing series here in New Zealand means that Toyota New Zealand fortunately do keep all of these panels on the shelf, and basically less than a week we had everything sitting here. In the meantime though, while we were pretty confident that the chassis rails weren't tweaked, we did take the opportunity, given that we have a panel shop literally a 200 meter push up the road from us, we pushed the car around there on Monday morning, got them to put it on their chassis machine and just take a few measurements and make sure that everything was straight, which turned out to be quite fortuitous because it wasn't straight. The chassis rails and the strut towers, which of course are the key components, were straight, but what they found is that there is some panel work, if I get my little pointer going in, there is some panel work here, kind of bolts to the inner chassis rail and then the guard or fender bolts onto that, and that was all moved across a little bit. Basically everything had sort of shunted that way, and I think the point around about here was 11 millimeters off to the left, so it wouldn't have really affected our wheel alignment or our ability to get the car to perform, but certainly might have made it a little bit tricky to line up our panel gaps nicely. So that was done inside of a day and a relatively small amount of money to pay to know that everything is straight. So if I can get back to, there we go, and that's what it looks like now, basically good as new. No one would ever know that I crashed the car if I stopped talking about it here in live webinars. Yeah, okay, maybe I should stop. On top of this, obviously, we've still got a bit of work to do getting it wrapped, and those panels are just sitting there. We've got a radiator and an intercooler to replace, so there is still a little bit of work ahead of us, but we're hoping we should have that back at least track ready in the not too distant future, and we can carry on just like nothing happened. Now, moving on to our next topic. If you haven't already started following our vlogs, please make sure you do so. We're pretty proud of them. They're getting a fairly good response, and it's giving you a slightly more lighthearted, behind-the-scenes look at what's going on around here at High Performance Academy. In particular, you get to meet a little bit more of the team than just myself, and you're going to get to sort of learn a little bit about how we actually shoot the features that we shoot as well. Head across to my laptop screen again, and this is our last vlog, which launched on Friday, episode 5, and we discuss in this in detail corner weighting and alignment. So during this vlog, we were actually shooting some content for our sister company, Racecraft, and I'm going to get into that in a bit in a second, because we're really proud to announce our second course release is coming up today. But this is the topic of corner weighting, which ties in really closely with Racecraft's earlier course release, the Motorsport Wheel Alignment Fundamentals course. If I can get through a little bit beyond where I'm just talking, we'll try and get into the actual action. So at that point there, we've got the car with a string alignment system on it. And so we talk a little bit about that, talk about how you can perform your own alignments at home without needing to break the bank in terms of the componentry that you are going to need to perform that. There are some advantages with this system as well, a string alignment system, namely that you can take it to the racetrack with you. So I know there's always the argument about the very expensive camera-based systems, and yes, I'm not here to say that they aren't great. There are some details that you'll get from a camera-based system that are very, very difficult to replicate with a string-based system. That being said, even the best camera-based system in the world is not strictly that portable, which is why you'll find race teams basically all through the highest levels of motorsport, right up to LMP1 and Formula 1, will use string alignment systems. This might look a little bit flasher than this, but the premise is still exactly the same. So once you've got your alignment set up, the other aspect, and I'm probably going to struggle to find the right timestamp in this, so just rest assured that it does happen. The other aspect is corner weighting, and this is something that we don't see so much at the grassroots level. Corner weighting is a process where what we do is we get the car up onto four scales, and we're measuring the amount of force being applied to the ground through each of the tires. And the idea here is that by manipulating, first of all, weight located in the chassis, so this is more useful when you are building a race car. Maybe you've got the ability to decide exactly whereabouts aspects such as the fuel cell, maybe the dry sump tank, the fire extinguisher system, etc. You can move all of these components around, and that can give you some benefit in getting the balance right for a start. If you're running in a race class that has a controlled minimum weight, then the other opportunity you have is to remove ballast, or move ballast, I should say, around the car to get your weight split how you want it, ideally. Then from there, the other aspect which is often overlooked is the ability to actually jack weight around the car by adjusting the ride height at individual corners of the car. And the premise here is that, for example, if we lift the ride height at the front right corner of the car by 2 millimeters, doesn't sound like much, but what that will do is have the effect of increasing the weight that we'll measure on the front right as well as the left rear corner. At the same time, obviously, because the car hasn't become heavier, the left front and the right rear wheels, the weight being applied through those to the ground will be reduced. So by doing this, what we're chasing typically, well, there are a number of parameters, what we're chasing typically for a circuit racing or a road racing application is a parameter called a 50% cross weight percentage. Sounds complex, but essentially all we mean there is that we're adding up the right front and the left rear weight, and we're expressing that as a percentage of the total weight. And there is a lot of other stuff that goes into this, so please don't take it out of context. Of course, the components in your car are still important, as is the alignment, as is your tire pressure. This all really comes into one all-encompassing aspect. But the premise here is if we can achieve a 50% crossweight percentage, we should be achieving a car, we should be getting a car that will handle consistently in both left and right-hand corners. And this is also going to add up to a car that's going to feel more balanced out on the racetrack and give the driver more confidence, particularly when attacking corners. So the Racecraft corner weighting course covers all of that information. And we are, the team right now, while I am presenting this webinar, they're putting the final touches on that. Should be available within the next 6 or 8 hours if everything goes well. That course is available at $129 US. While it isn't, if we just jump across to our website. So if you go to racecrafthq.com and if you click on courses up here in the top, that will take you to our courses page. Obviously, right now, we've got our Motorsport Wheel Alignment Fundamentals course and that corner weighting course will pop up there as well. So we're really excited to have it out there. I think while corner weighting is definitely nothing new and competitors at the top levels of professional motorsport will be corner weighting their cars essentially between every session, definitely at the grassroots and enthusiast level, it's something that is almost completely and universally overlooked. And there really are significant advantages if you can get your car corner weighted correctly, the ability to adjust that to optimize the balance of your car for a particular track, driver preference as well as conditions is invaluable. Does require a little bit of investment in the equipment. Fortunately, corner weight scales have come down quite dramatically over the years I've been involved in racing. You can purchase these for as low as about $1,000 US right now. Other systems, $1,500 to $2,000 US. It does sound like a chunk of cash, but one of the advantages with corner weight scales is it's not a product that you need to use every day. And for this reason, particularly if you've got a few racing buddies that you tend to go to the track with, you can actually pull your funds there and purchase a set of corner weight scales between maybe 2 to 4 different competitors. And this way you can share the use of the corner weight scales. It's not going to break the bank and you've got that resource sitting there for you. Which leads me to my next topic. No, it doesn't. I'm going to talk about a completely different aspect now, which is the release that we've just done on our YouTube channel today. So again, if we head across to my laptop screen. So this is an interview that we shot back at PRI last year, back when the world was a little bit different and we were all allowed to travel. And this was an interview with Orleon from bFlash. I've got a bFlash tuning unit here. The conversation really got down into the intricacies of reflashing European vehicles in particular. And here in New Zealand, we are a little bit limited. We don't see so many of the European car market here particularly. While we obviously have Audi, Volkswagen and BMW in New Zealand, the tuning industry for those models is definitely not as developed as it is obviously in Europe. And we see people constantly asking questions about tuning solutions for European vehicles. And it's quite different because for the mainstream, it's fair to say that we don't necessarily have the support that we do for a lot of maybe the US domestic market and Japanese domestic market models. Some commercial software that makes things nice and easy. There's a lot of commercial systems out there, but more often than not, what we find is that the definitions, which is kind of the roadmap for whereabouts the different maps inside of the raw hexadecimal ROM file are contained, those can be really limited. They can be completely inaccurate, and at best they can limit what you actually can adjust. So what we've found is that a lot of the professional tuners that are heavily developed in the European tuning market will actually use software such as Winnows to find their own maps inside that raw hexadecimal file. And this becomes a little bit tricky because, first of all, that's a skill set that I personally don't believe too many tuners have. We're sort of getting a crossover now between someone who can tune an engine and someone who's essentially a coder, or maybe even you could refer to as a hacker, being able to reverse engineer a factory ECU and work out where the maps are and how they all function. So again, that's not a skill that too many tuners will generally have. The other thing is, because there's a lot of work in this, there's a lot of IP involved, and this really limits how much information these tuners who know what they're doing want to give out. So that's been quite hard in general. So the bFlash unit, and it's something that we plan to spend a bit of time with hopefully this year, basically is a software and hardware package that works with the wider range of European vehicles. There's the ability to bench flash as well as flash through the OBD2 port. I can get it right, OBD2. There we go, got it in the end. And also that's going to depend on the ECU that you are tuning. The more important part there, the hardware and software required to actually read and write to the ECU is only one part of the puzzle. As I mentioned, the definitions are the other part. So we talked to Orleans about how the average tuning shop can get good definitions, and that goes through another part of bFlash's business. So if you are interested in learning a little bit more about European vehicle tuning, head across to our YouTube channel and have a look at that video. Lastly, for today, we are still running our Earnest / HPA giveaway. So that is a giveaway of workshop clothing from our sister brand Earnest Clothing, or Earnest Co, I should say, which involves this fabrication apron that I am wearing here. Don't really need to use it just for fabrication. I like to use it for presenting webinars. If you want to bake a cake, you can wear it for that too. We're not here to judge you. You'll also get a pair of Earnest overalls, and you're going to get a pair of Earnest pants, which I'm wearing, which are a little bit hard to show you, and an Earnest too. On top of that, you're also going to get HPA VIP membership, which gives you access to all of the courses we currently offer, as well as every course we release in the future. This actually also gives you VIP membership to our ETS Fab School, our online fabrication school, as well as Racecraft. And I've just already mentioned Racecraft in there as well. There's still a little bit of time left to get your name into the draw. The value of that package, I think, is a touch over $2,500. So it is a really great package, particularly with that VIP membership. The more courses we release, the more valuable that VIP membership becomes, and it never expires. So if you want to get your name into the draw, I'll get Sam to drop a link into the comments that you can follow. There are a few little tasks there you can complete to give yourself a few more entries. For now, thank you for watching our pre-show. Give me a few moments and we'll get started on today's lesson.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.